Hello, this is a football fans podcast from CelticUnderground.net. I'm Harry Brady, and this week I'm going to be joined by St Anthony to discuss the First League and First League Cup game of the season against Hearts and Kilmarnock. So, obviously, by the way, you're listening to this, you'll know that some people actually think that there is some planning involved in this podcast, and there is not. It's really thrown together. So the problem with that is I sometimes lose track of what cover versions or intros or new music I've done or haven't done and who's recommended it. So for the people who recommended today's, I apologise. I will track you down and give you a mention somewhere else. The first one underneath just now is the covers off both the intro and the cover version, and that's Sound and Vision by Franz Ferdinand. And then at the end of the podcast, we've got Danny Wilson, Knowing Me, Knowing You, live. So, enough from me. If you want to get your new music on, if you want to get a recommendation for a cover version or for a fantastic intro, you can email podcasts at CelticUnderground.net. That's podcast plural at CelticUnderground.net. You can tweet myself at Harry Brady CU or tweet any of the guys. You can email about any subject. Thanks very much for the people who've been emailing in and sending in the comments. I will put you back in the capable hands of Franz Ferdinand, and then it'll be St Anthony chatting with myself, Harry Brady.
Wonder sometimes by sound and vision.
So I am joined now by St Anthony. How are you doing, Saint?
I'm very well, thanks.
So, new season, new excitement. Season's begun with a victory over Hearts, a rampant victory in the League Cup, and a bit of a rammy, a good old-fashioned rammy between two managers. So let's move to the Hearts game first of all. So tell me about your thoughts on the Hearts game.
Unfortunately, I wasn't at the Hearts game because I had a funeral.
I go and get you a podcast and then you go and tell me you weren't at the game.
I managed to see most of it. One of the problems in a half 12 kickoff is that when you get funerals and stuff, that you're virtually no chance of getting to the match. And if it had been a 3 o'clock kickoff, it would have been fine. However, I did see most of it on TV, and I probably got a better view on the telly than I would have at the game.
Do you know what, I feel like moving into a Jimmy Sanderson. Could you not have got them to move the funeral? Tight question.
I know. Are you at the game, call?
Yeah, exactly. So, you managed to get to watch most of it.
Yeah, and I was actually quite impressed for the point of view that I thought that we took the game by the scruff of the neck for the beginning, and the result was never in any doubt, and there was a lot of plus points that came from it. But when you've won a treble like we did last season, there can be a sort of anti-climax feel to the beginning of the season, but that's not happened, which is a good thing, and I think it speaks volumes for the professionalism of Brendan Rodgers and the players.
So, one of the things that I think will be an interesting dynamic this season is the continuation of this unbeaten run. Because whenever it ends, the Scottish press will make a really big deal of it. Do you think the longer it goes that we're unbeaten domestically, that the players will then start to think again about trying to stay unbeaten?
I hope that it doesn't really get through the players' mind. I think if you're a real professional and you're focused on the game, and you're not focusing on records, and you're not focusing on unbeaten runs and stuff. You're very much get your eye in what's happening in the next game, and concentrating on that. I think that the media will hype it up, and maybe even some of the supporters to a lesser degree will keep it going as well. But the only thing you can see is the record's got to go sometimes, but let's see how far we can get. But let's see if we can really go to town and maybe get it into the 50s and 60s before somebody happens to beat us.
So, game on Saturday, the team, were you happy with the team? The team was Gordon, Lustig, Simonovic, Beaton, Tierney. So first up, Beaton playing at centre-half with their injuries. Your thoughts on that?
I thought Beaton played well. I also thought he played well in Rosenborg in Norway when he came on in the second leg. I think he's an intelligent player. I don't think he's the bravest for a centre-half. I think if he came up against a big John Harps and Chris Sutton type, I think he might toil a wee bit. But certainly in terms of the players that we come up against in the SPL, I don't think Beaton should have too much trouble coping with them. And apparently it's a role that he's played in the past, and I read somewhere that he's quite comfortable playing in that role. And he's a big lad as well. And he does what Brendan wants from the back. He'll take the ball in an upward position in the penalty area, and he'll play his way out of defence, because it's very clear that that's the way Brendan wants the team to play. Mm-hmm. Everybody's hearts in their mouth when Craig Gordon tries these chipped passes to the fullbacks, or tries these short passes to the penalty area to the centre backs. But you know that's Brendan.
Is your heart still in your mouth at that? I thought we'd moved on from the area. So your heart's
down. I don't want to tempt fate, but there's always that feeling that it just takes one bad pass and you're going to lose a daft goal and we're going to look daft. So, but that's the way he wants him to play, and it's laudable. I mean, that's the way to go. It's entertaining stuff, and it's a very technical game we're playing. And yet you have to say that it's very impressive the way that they can build from the back. I mean, Beaton's pass through Griffiths for the first goal on Saturday, but it was immense. I mean, that was terrific. So it was
although the Hearts defence and keeper didn't exactly cover themselves in glory in the way that they dealt with it.
No, but that was, I think you need Griffiths a bit of credit for showing quickness of thought to get the ball from under his feet and get it into the net.
Absolutely. It's one of those ones where, as a Celtic fan, you're looking at it going, "Oh, Griffiths did well to do that," and you just know if you were a Hearts fan watching that, you'd just be heading your hands at how they dealt with it or didn't particularly deal with it. Then the middle of the park was started off with Injam and Brown, and then Injam got injured and Armstrong came on. For him, or get substituted and Armstrong came on for him. How did you see that going?
I think the guy, Jam, he's still finding his feet. And I think there's two things. I think sometimes players find it hard to come to terms with the pace of the Scottish game. And also, I think some players find that it takes a wee while to find their feet in terms of the pressure of being a Celtic player. Mm-hmm. So I don't think the Heat have remotely seen the best of him yet. I think he's only showed flashes, and I'm hoping that he's got more in him. I think Armstrong is going to be a huge loss to us. I don't think there's any doubt he's leaving. It's my belief that if he was going to stay, he'd have seen the contract by now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you see him on Saturday when he came on and you saw him the other night against Kilmarnock, the attacking midfielder that we've not had really since Stylian Petrov is there, and, you know, when he moves on, that'll be a big, big blow for us. That'll be a sad one.
Although, I mean, I think... was I saw earlier today, what was interesting for me was the pass map for Celtic. I mean, I thought away to Rosenborg and at home to Rosenborg, Brown was quite wasteful compared to the stats that he had in the Champions League last season. Yet despite that, you could see that everything went through Brown, absolutely everything in Rosenborg went through Brown. But the pass map that I saw for the Hearts game up to the 67th minute when Encham was on, it was actually a lot of stuff went through Encham, and it was much more, it was actually more of a balance in terms of stuff on the left hand side went through Encham, stuff on the right hand side went through Brown, bit of interchange between Brown and Encham, but he was, I felt it was quite sort of Paul Lambert-esque in terms of he's just keeping the ball moving. The ball comes to him and he just moves it on. The ball comes to him and he just moves it on. And the difference, I know we've had some text conversations about Beaton, comparing him with Beaton as a midfielder. And,
yeah,
and you can see this in the pass map. I think he's more forward passing than Beaton.
They're similar styles. They like to get in the ball and they like to keep the ball moving. They're good passers. They anticipate well. Typical European technical midfield players. I think that he's very similar to Beaton for what I've seen so far.
But I would argue his difference with Beaton is my criticism of Beaton. He's a bit slower trying to pass it on, and also he's a bit more sideways in his passes than Cham. If you look at his pass map, there's a lot more forward passes because he's on the left side of midfield and he's got Tierney as an option for his forward passes. But yeah, I would maybe argue that. So, but you're right, Armstrong will be a miss, and isn't it amazing? 12 months ago, who'd have thought we'd be doing a podcast and saying Armstrong's going to be a miss?
Well, here's a funny thing, because Owen Coyle was in one of the newspapers at the weekend, I can't remember which one it was, and he said that he tried to get Armstrong for approximately £1 million last year, maybe just below £1 million, and Brendan wasn't entertaining it. But I have to say that if Armstrong had left then, I don't think anybody would have been tremendously upset. And they'd been happy to maybe see him move on to get somebody else in. So it goes to show how 12 months is a short period, but also it shows you the value of a good manager, a good coach that can take players and make them better.
Absolutely, which is something we can maybe talk on when we discuss the Kilmarnock game. So then we, in the middle of the park, we had Forrest, Sinclair, Forrest, McGregor and Sinclair behind Griffiths up front. So were you surprised that McGregor got the nod ahead of Rogic?
No, I think similar to last season, I think Brendan's going to alternate between the two of them, and I think McGregor's a very underrated player who is coming to the fore in the eyes of the supporters. I think there's more of an appreciation of what McGregor does now. And I thought he's another one that had a good game in Norway against Rosenborg. And when you saw the Hearts game, you know, McGregor could have had a hat-trick. I mean, he's firing shots in every opportunity. And he has got a goal in the midfield. So, you know, if Armstrong does move on, then I think McGregor could comfortably go into that position that Armstrong plays and probably... you might have a ready-made replacement rather than having to go into the transfer market to get somebody else.
Yeah, so it was good to see Griffiths back playing up front. The movement that he does, I just think he's a much more rounded striker than he was 12 months ago. I know that one of Brendan's criticisms of him last year was he was too obsessed with thinking that strikers must always score goals. That as long as the team's scoring, it doesn't matter, because if the team's scoring and the striker has created space, and the ideal example of that is Chris Sutton from in our more recent past, of a guy who was vital to the way the team played at times. But he was never a prolific goal scorer. But he knew. He created the space for Henrik Larsson.
Well, there's no doubt about that. I mean, Sutton was a very intelligent player. I was a huge Sutton fan. And you're absolutely right in what you say there, that Henrik benefited. As good as Henrik was, and he was tremendous, there's no doubt that he benefited from Sutton's physical presence in the team, and also Sutton's intelligence of positional sense on the field, and you know that he could lead the line in the days that you had a genuine forward line. Maybe it's different these days, but you've got the one guy who's up, and it's a different system that they play these days. But you're right about Griffiths, because it was noticeable that in Rosenberg the team weren't playing badly, but it just wasn't clicking. And as soon as Griffiths came on and he knew where to take up position and he knew where to make the runs, everything just clicked into place. It was wonderful to see. And the hope is that Griffiths can stay fit, because the worry, well, we have the one up front system that we play, we're very much reliant on the effectiveness of the guy who's a striker, and both Griffiths and Dembele can play it very, very well. And it's just a hope that they can remain injury free.
Well, now, where do you? I mean, obviously, that's the system we're going to play, one up front. So, where do you sit on the signing of a third striker thing?
Yeah, the hope is that you're not going to need the third striker, in which case you may be paying a good wage for no reason. Like, for example, last season Griffiths got injured near the beginning of the season, Dembele took over, and then through the winter Dembele got an injury and Griffiths took over, so they were able to alternate between the two of them, and the two of them ended up with a tremendous scoring records. The problem came when both of them were injured around about just after New Year, and Sinclair had to take the mantle of playing striker, which he's not comfortable with.
Yeah.
So yeah, you're taking a bit of a gamble with a third striker if you've only got two. But the one thing I would take Brendan to, you know, take exception to Brendan, is that he made a comment how good Ayer had played in the game that he was playing. Now, I think if you can play a 17-year-old centre-half, sorry, a 19-year-old centre-half, then you can play maybe an 18, 19-year-old striker. And the boy Hutchinson should certainly be in the bench. And coming on and maybe coming on later in the game and gaining experience while we have the opportunity, and then he might become the third striker that we require, and he'll be a cheaper option, of course.
I agree in terms of Aitchison, and I think they do plan. And I think they expect Aitchison to become the player. I think, from what I understand, they just think he needs to be a wee bit physically stronger to be able to cope at the top level with professionals. And I think the dilemma is, and I understand the point that Brendan Kitaly makes, and it's not, I do find it funny that people are talking about you sign a third striker and automatically you signed as the third choice striker or whatever. Whoever you sign, the issue will be, see, you went out and spent £10 million and this guy became your first choice striker. Well, then Lee Griffiths would probably then become the third choice striker. And if if all three of them are fit with the £10 million striker starting and Dembele on the bench and Griffiths sitting in the stands, by Christmas Griffiths is going to ask for it. It's going to be peed off because he's not getting a game, and ask for a transfer. You then sell Griffiths and you're back to two strikers.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to go daft and buy a third striker. I think that would be a waste of money, to be frank. I don't think we need to worry on that front. However, I just think that Aitchison would be maybe the preference for the third striker, just even to keep him on the bench.
And I think as supporters, I mean, this is where I think sometimes supporters are a bit two-faced. As supporters, we love nothing better than young players coming through the system and playing. Look at the adulation for Kieran Tierney. And as supporters, we want nothing more than Celtic to go out and splash the cash and go and sign a star player. If you go and splash the cash, then you're blocking the place for youngsters to come through. So you can't. It's difficult to have it both ways, is the point. And I think you're right. I think the option of Aitchison is trying to ease Aitchison in. We keep hearing they really rate Aitchison, so trying to ease him into the system That seems logical to me. The other option that Brendan Rodgers and Chris Davis have both talked about is signing a wide player, so a player who most of the time, when you've got Griffiths and Dembele fit, will be playing out wide, who isn't too uncomfortable playing through the middle. And I think that's where a lot of the Patrick Roberts rumours have come from, because he's the guy that they have identified would fit their bill for them.
Well, I think Forrest has shown that he's got the intelligence to play through the centre, and it's interesting to note that Forrest, when in his younger days in the Celtic youth team, was a striker alongside, I think it's a boy Keating that went on to Hibs and then he went to Hearts.
Uh-huh.
Sadly, he got a bad injury and it held him back at Celtic. But the point I'm making is that Forrest has experience of playing this role when he was younger, and I would like to see him play through the centre, because I think out of the wide players that we have, he's the one who probably is most comfortable playing through the centre if he has to. And I wouldn't have any qualms about playing Forrest. And I think his pace in particular, it's almost like similar years ago to maybe Bobby Lennox, when Bobby Lennox was a fairly mediocre left winger before Jock Steen came, and yet when Steen became the manager, although he still played in a number of 11 shots, Bobby wasn't really a left winger. He sort of played through the centre.
Mm-hmm.
And used his pace to great effect when guys like Bobby Murdoch and Bertie Auld were firing balls into space for him to run onto. So Forrest is getting that in him. He's so fast, he's electric, and I think he would quite relish that, maybe having a wee go at playing at centre forward.
So what are your thoughts on Patrick Roberts coming back?
I'm a big Patrick Roberts fan. I think there's not many Celtic fans that aren't, and I would be absolutely ecstatic if I thought Patrick would come back. Brendan's put together a very entertaining team, and a team that scores goals, a very attacking team, very much in the Celtic traditional mould. But there is something about Paddy Roberts when he gets the ball. He's got that low centre of gravity, he drops the shoulder, he skips by a guy, he beats the guy, and he's not just a fancy dander. I mean there is an end product to Patrick Roberts as well. He can cross a ball, he can finish. He's got so much to his game, and if they're saying that they think he can play through the centre, then that's even better. But I'm a big fan, and it'd be interesting to see if we do get him, whether it's on loan or permanently, because I don't know if we still have the finance to maybe go the whole road and sign him permanently, because that would cost an awful lot of money, and I'm not sure our board of directors have got that in them.
Well, I think that in terms of all the Patrick Roberts rumours, we saw only yesterday. God, do you know it's the nature of modern and social media and stuff like that you read stuff so many times over and over again, that stuff that's just 24 hours old feels ancient because you've read so many references to it. But Tuesday night, I had a conversation with someone that made me think it was 50-50 for Patrick Roberts to come back, that mm-hmm. it was between us and Nice, and we both were prepared to match the money that was required, and it just came down to whether he wanted to come back to the shitty weather of Scotland or live in Nice. Personally, I'd take a five, if I was earning that type of money, I'd take a £5,000 pay cut to go and live in the south of France rather than come to Scotland. But anyway, I then found out later in the night, I then get a text from someone saying, actually, Nice have gone and signed somebody else because Patrick Roberts said that he wanted to come to Glasgow. And so I put that online, and I read somebody say, I saw somebody referring to somebody else saying, you know, I'm looking for better, excuse me, sources than the BBC.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, on Patrick Roberts, the BBC is the best source you can get, because two people who work for Patrick Roberts' agency.
Well, it's Alan Preston's one, isn't it?
Yeah, they're on the BBC. Are. So whatever the BBC are saying, it's probably spot on.
Mm-mm.
And the gist of it is, as you say, excuse me, the gist of it is Man City are not that keen. They want to hold on to him, and they want to loan him out.
They have to be sensible as well, because with the greatest respect, and I'm a huge Patrick fan, as I've just said there, he isn't going to get a game for Manchester City, because should there be an injury or something happen, then City don't. I mean, if you're spending £40 million or £50 million rather on Kyle Walker to play fullback, then you're not going to balk at the opportunity of buying an Italian or a Spanish or a German winger that when you've got a space in your team who's a ready-made article. So it annoys me a wee bit that Chelsea's and Manchester City's hog so many good players and basically deny them the right to earn they're earning a living and they're earning a good wage, but they're not playing, and I get really frustrated at that. I think,
yeah, but the modern football world, if a player turns around and says, "I want to go," let's go. I mean, look at Van Dijk.
Yeah,
he's going to leave Southampton because he's told Southampton he wants to be Ofsky. If, you know, the issue I understand is Man City want to hold on to him and see, right? But they do not believe that a loan to Celtic would develop him any further. Because playing against Kilmarnock and Ross County and Motherwell and the Rangers and the like is not giving him the challenge that they would want him to get. I understand that's the issue. And then your £50 million for Kyle Walker. Well, isn't that part of the problem? Because Man City are looking, thinking, yeah, we could probably get £15-20 million for Patrick Roberts just because it's the bonkers world of the English Premiership. And that's what players go for. And we're not going to pay £15 million quid for Patrick Roberts.
Another point I would make about Patrick Roberts as well is I hear people saying, oh, you shouldn't be getting him in loan, you should be trying to get him permanently. But imagine if we do get Patrick for another 18 months, just hypothetically, that means you've had him for 3 years. If he signed him permanently for 3 years, there's a good chance at the end of the 3 year contract he'd be off.
Yeah.
So we have to be realistic.
Well, imagine we signed him for £10 million quid. Imagine we got, as you say, for another 18 months. And we got him for 3 years. Well, imagine if at the beginning of the time we'd sold him, we bought him for £10 million quid, and at the end of 3 years sold him for £10 million quid. Okay, we'd be saying, well, it's a pity we didn't make a profit, but we'd still be chuffed to bits that we got a fantastic player and we got our money back at the end of it.
And
it's the same
cost
neutral position.
Yeah.
So last night on Radio Scotland, as you say, Alan Preston, one of the people from Patrick Roberts' agency, Chris McLaughlin was saying it was 70-30, and Alan Preston said, we'll know within 48 to 72 hours. So, as I say, my understanding is it's a discussion of a loan deal and the percentage of his wages. We'd be prepared to, that they want a loan club to spend. We'd be prepared to spend it. It's just whether they think there's any benefit from coming to Celtic. I mean, the other way of looking at it is the nature of clubs underneath the top six in English football is they sign players who are virtually all their players are 6 foot plus in every position. Patrick Roberts is a luxury player, and if you're on the front foot playing like Celtic, he's a luxury.
You're on time there, I'll tell you why. I think Brendan's got a system, and the system is very much reliant on the two wide players being disciplined and talented. Disciplined when they've not got the ball and that they tuck in the midfield, and also talented as in when we do have the ball, they have to create, and they also have to score goals, because when you want to get one up front, it makes it more of an onus.
And when I said it was a luxury player, what I was meaning was for the teams that play the type of boring football that happens in English Premiership below the top six, where they just want lots of physicality and people who run about fast. Having a small, diminutive winger is a luxury for them. It's not a luxury for us, as you say. It's a we're the perfect type of team for him. We play in the front foot. We give the ball to attractive players and say, go and play football. I think he fits. It's the same reason why I always thought Gary Hooper leaving Celtic would never be a success anywhere else. because he needs to play in a team that's playing attacking football on the front foot all the time. And he was never going to go to a Man United or a Man City or a Chelsea or a Tottenham. So when he leaves Celtic, he's going to play wherever he went. If he left Celtic to the English Premiership, he was going to go to a team who didn't play a style of football that suited him. And that's my concern, that Patrick Roberts doesn't get to come to Celtic. He ends up going to a team that with a style of football that doesn't suit Patrick Roberts.
And Alan Preston made the point the other night on Radio Scotland that part of the attraction for Patrick Roberts to come back to Celtic is the fact that it's time on the ball, because you could easily sign for somebody, you could sign for Brighton or Burnley or mediocre dross in the English Premiership, and he may only get a couple of touches, literally may only get a couple of touches in a game. Because, you know, these teams are going to go to your Man United's and Man City's and Liverpool, and they're basically going to do what Ross County and Kilmarnock do when they come to Celtic Park, is 10 men behind the ball, one man up front. So it's going to be a hard shift for Patrick. Whereas when he comes to Celtic, you're playing in a team that's totally designed to attack, and you're playing in a league where you know that you're playing with the biggest team in it, and you're going to get a lot of time on the ball, which has been proved in the time he's been there. You know, we just fed him time after time after time and let him run at the defenders. So I think in terms of enjoying your professional years as a player, I think I'm hoping that Patrick might that might be one of the things that sways it in Celtic's favour.
So we thumped Hearts. The only thing that bugged me about the Hearts game was, it's a bit harsh to say it bugged me, but we sort of completely switched off with 10, 12 minutes to go. And that's how Hearts managed to get a goal, because our defence just completely switched off. The game was won, they were poor.
The defence switched off, but it was a savable shot and it was poor goalkeeping. You know, Craig Gordon would have been disappointed with that one, and I think hopefully he's going to get that out of his system, because if he makes a mistake like that in any of the games against Astana, then they'll be
healthy. So, I think it was a simple thing of everybody had switched off, the guy goes through, and then Craig Gordon's expecting the guy to cross it, so he waits on his right hand side moving away from the near post and the guy hits it in at the inside post, and it was one of those ones that was really weird at the game where For a split second, you didn't actually realise the ball had gone in the back of the net, because not even the Hearts fans were celebrating. And you actually thought it had like hit the side net and rolled round the back.
Yeah.
And then you realise, someone's going in the back of the net to get this ball.
The only thing I would say to that as well is that if you're 4-0 up and you lose a goal, I don't think you should get too upset. Then again, you don't want to happen again, so you try and make sure it doesn't happen the next time.
It reminded me a bit of, remember in the old Celtic Park, if you were at the back of the Celtic end and somebody scored in the goals at the Rangers end, the one, it took you a split second, and particularly if it happened in the Rangers game, and then two, for a split second there was no noise in their end because you were so far away, and then all of a sudden you just hear that dreaded far away yes, and you'd be like,
horrible,
yeah, bastard, they scored.
horrible feeling.
Yes. So that was the League Cup game, the league game. So we're on to the League Cup. So what were your thoughts when you saw the team for the Kilmarnock game?
I'd heard the team coming up in the car, and I knew there was 8 changes. And to be honest, I expected that, because there's a lot of big games coming up, and Brendan's going to want to keep guys fresh. And he has got a big squad, so he's entitled to change things about now and again. The guy next to me who was sitting at the match, he was concerned before the game that maybe we'd made too many changes, and you know, Kilmarnock maybe fancy their chances, but as it happened, they just blew them away. I mean, for the first kickoff, there was only going to be one winner, and I think if you look at it from a Kilmarnock perspective, it was a poor performance. I mean, we can only beat what's put in front of us, but I think when you face a Celtic team who were fairly under strength, and you might never get a better chance of getting a result at Celtic Park, then I think Kilmarnock lacked ambition. They sat in again and didn't make. And a cup tie, I don't understand why teams don't play a more open game and try and get a result.
I was actually going to say, I actually thought they fell between two stones in that regard, and that they didn't completely sit in, but they didn't completely attack. And so the consequence was they weren't enough on the front foot to cause us any problem, but they weren't sufficiently sitting in that then resulted in us having loads of space to play in between the lines of midfield and defence. And that was part of the problem. I mean, I actually think that's sometimes why some of the League Cup games that we play are quite enjoyable, because teams have to try and win the game and they give us space to play in.
Yeah.
But before we go on, breaking news, all around the world this news is breaking. Rangers have been drawn away from home in a cup game.
Well, do you know what? I'm going to be honest here and say that I was doing something earlier on and I forgot about it. So let me guess, Livingston?
No. Like real breaking news. Apparently Donald Trump is going to be making a statement on this, and North Korea are also going to be making a statement, and Theresa May has called a press conference because Rangers have been drawn away from home to an SPL team.
Oh, that must be. I'm going to go for Hibs.
No, fortunately for Rangers, obviously we can't have them playing outside the city of Glasgow, so they've been drawn against Thistle.
Thistle may fancy their chances, because last season they were desperately unlucky in the two games at Firhill. Really, really unlucky, painfully unlucky. And they might fancy it. So, good for Thistle. And who did we get? What are the points?
We are away to Dundee.
Ah, well, take that.
So, interesting times. I will tell you the full draw. Obviously, the people listening to this already know the draw. But anyway, Hibs at home to Livy, Motherwell against Aberdeen, Dundee Celtic, Thistle Rangers.
They're quite good ties, actually. You know, quite entertaining ties.
Yeah. So, couldn't tell you when they played.
Hang on, they
must be soon. That's about all I can work out. So there we go. So yes, and the back four, what was it, the age of the back four? Was it Ralston was 18, Ayer 18, Tierney 19, and Miller 18? Was it something like that? Or is Ayer still 17 in fact?
Yeah, that's what only adds to Kilmarnock's pain, if you like, because they didn't have it in them to make a better game of it. Having said that, you need to give credit to our boys, because they were organised and they were alert, they looked fit, and they're everything that you'd be looking for in Celtic players. I have to say that out the pick of the bunch for me is the big Norwegian guy, Ayer. He just looks to me like another Johan Mjelby. Yeah, Johan Mjelby map too, and I was a big Mjelby fan. So I'm really optimistic about his chances in the future. I think he looks a tremendous prospect. He's so dominant in the air, and he's got everything. He can pass a ball. He's got a physical presence. You never see him flustered either. He seems quite a cool big guy, typical Scandinavian. And he's got a big future ahead of him. And I've no doubt, hopefully, that Brendan has got him earmarked for a place in the season ahead.
Well, I was impressed with Ayer. Obviously, I was impressed with Tierney. I also was impressed with Ralston. Do you know the thing that got me after the Hearts game on Saturday? I was hanging about after the game, and they had a small park training session on the pitch, about an eighth of the pitch. And I found out that the reason they have it was all the subs. Even the guys who came on as a sub, all the subs, plus the people who'd been in the squad that didn't get stripped. And I found out that, and if you go on our website, you'll see there's a 4-minute video. If you go on our website, and the last minute of that video is this training session, and you'll see that what I found out is one of the reasons why they have this very, very small pitched training session with, it's like six aside, was because of playing in such a confined space, it gets the players used to having to receive the ball, control it, pass it on and move it when you're permanently under pressure. You've got no time and there's always someone next to you. The other thing that really struck me on it is I know that the substitute goalkeeper, Connor Hazard, is 6'6".
Mm-hmm.
And I knew that Ralston was getting bigger, but as they walked off the park, Ralston was like almost the same height as him.
He is a big lad, and he's, but the thing is, he's mobile as well. You know, he's a somebody described him recently. He's a big unit.
Yes, he's also he's got a neck like a tree trunk. It's enormous. and he took his goal well. He powered that header in.
Well, he created one as well, which was just as impressive. I don't think Lustig is going to last forever, and there is always a worry that you get injuries over the course of the season as well. So having Ralston there again might save his money in the long run. But you've also got Gamboa there as well, so there's cover in those areas.
I think it's interesting actually that Gamboa hasn't, it's not like he's been playing first team football, and then when mm-hmm. we play that game last night, it's Ralston who gets the call as right back and not Gamboa.
Yeah.
But that was quite telling.
I think he would also be telling if Lustig get injured for next week. I don't think Ralston would be getting on. I think Gamboa would get it because of his experience, which is only quite right.
I don't know, because I was speaking to someone about the issue with when Sviatchenko got injured against Rosenborg, and the camera panned to Gamboa, and the expectation was Gamboa would come on and Lustig would move into the middle. But the issue is, we play with a four at the back, where Brendan likes Tierney to push on so that it effectively becomes a three.
Yeah.
And that's fine with Lustig, because he's naturally more defensive and tucks in.
Mm-hmm.
And Tony Ralston is also naturally more defensive and happy to tuck in.
Mm-hmm.
What was more or less conveyed to me is that Gamboa's much more attacking. And so it'd be the equivalent of playing Tierney. It'd be the equivalent of playing two Tierneys in terms of attacking fullbacks, and be left with two. And that Gamboa's biggest problem is how is Tierney, and our backup to Tierney is now Calvin Miller, who's also an attacking person. So I don't know. I mean, certainly I'm being told they expect that Ralston by the end of the season might be challenging Lustig for the first choice right back position at Celtic.
I don't doubt it. I mean, he's obviously made strides, and he's one for the future. And as I said there, Lustig isn't getting any younger. He's not going to be about forever. But I think we'll see more of Ralston this season, that's for sure.
What did you think of the middle of the park? What did you think of Kouassi?
He was playing well when he got injured. Is there any word on the injury? Because last night Brendan would he comment, because he said it was too early, and he said it would be a day or so before they could be safe or deaf that what was up with him. So fingers crossed that there isn't anything serious, and the boy can carry on, because he did look the part last night. He was aggressive. He was a sort of ball-winning guy, sort of Scott Brown type, if you like.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because I was asking someone why Kouassi hasn't played more, and was told because he is the identical player to Scott Brown.
It would be difficult to have two such players in the side at the same time. Just the same as the way that it's unlikely that Griffiths and Dembele would play together as well. So I just hope that he does have a bad injury, because I don't think he's had the best of times since he's came here. I think he's found it hard to maybe come to terms with the Scottish game. So the hope is that he's finding his feet now, and this will be a big season for him.
Doesn't help when you arrive with malaria.
No. He's had his issues, which is a shame. Sometimes that happens, and it's just into fate and bad luck.
So then Armstrong in, and Hayes, Rogic, Benyu and Griffiths. So the sort of front four unit of Hayes, Rogic, Benyu and Griffiths, how did you feel that they played?
Let's start with Benyu. I'm not convinced about him so far. I think the games I've seen him playing, he's flat up to deceive. He is still a boy though, and I wouldn't want to be too critical of him, but some of the things he's trying hasn't come off yet, and I think we need to appreciate as well that he doesn't have a lot of experience behind him compared to some of the guys in the team. I mean, for example, I don't think he ever played the first team for Ipswich, and he got moved on to one of the lower division teams. So he's coming here with limited experience, and I think he'll take a wee while to find his feet, possibly.
I understand your point about his Ipswich thing. I understand that he was a star coming through the ranks at Ipswich. So when he then got to first team squad level, he was a bit full of himself, and was sent to Aldershot to teach him a lesson and also to get some first team football. And when he came to Celtic, it was very much the scouting, the part of the scouting division that looks for projects that we can work on, and he wasn't envisaged as being a first team player. But it was when Brendan Rodgers saw him training at Celtic that he decided, the plan was, I think Brendan said this himself, the plan was for him to come in and then be moved immediately on to a loan for a year. And it was Brendan who's, when he saw him in training, but like you, I thought it was one of those ones, it was a real dilemma for Brendan last night. Do you whip the boy off at half time because he's having such a nightmare, but that could dent his confidence even more?
I don't think he was having a nightmare. I think
he stood on the ball and fell over the ball, and
he was probably trying too hard to impress, because he seems to be one of these players that's, he's maybe got a wee trick in him, and he's keen to beat a man and get the crowd behind him, and that wasn't working last night, which is a pity. I wouldn't write him off. All I'm saying is that so far I don't think he's shown a great deal, but again, as I was trying to explain there, that some people take their time a little to find their feet at Celtic.
Do you know what I thought, and it was only when he came on that I thought about this, it was a real compliment to Callum McGregor. You know how games like that, it tends to be that you have some of your better first team players, the ones you put on the bench just in case you need to dig yourself out of a hole. I thought it was a real compliment to Callum McGregor that he was one of those core first team players on the bench for digging out the hole. You know, in terms of how he's moved on in the pecking order of the squad.
Well, we touched upon him earlier there, and my point was that I think there's more of an appreciation from the supporters about Callum McGregor. I think maybe about a year or 18 months ago there was a feeling that he was maybe a wee bit too lightweight for what we had, or for what we required. But I do think that people see him in a different light now, because he had a great end to the season last year. I mean, he was scoring goals, he was creating goals, and he had a great end to the season. So yeah, Callum's been there now for, I would say, probably this is maybe fourth season as a first team squad player.
I can't remember, he was out on loan to Notts County when Lennon was manager. And then
Dyla basically brought him back, the first one he Dyla.
Yeah, I think it was. So that's the two Dyla and three. So there, this is his fourth season now.
He's crammed in a lot in that time. And he's a very clever player. Callum McGregor is not your typical Scottish midfielder. He's very continental. He's got a lovely touch. His technique's great. He takes the ball in tight positions and he keeps it moving, and he's a good passer. So he's got a lot going for him this season.
He's got very fast feet, I think, to to borrow the phrase of Mark Cooper, I keep saying fidgety feet and he keeps giving me a hard time. It's twitchy feet. I think he's got very, very, it's what I always liked about Sean Maloney. I always felt Sean Maloney, it was his quick feet right outside the box that paid off, because people fouled him because they didn't quite know what he was up to. And you got lots of good free kicks to the edge of the box because of his play, and then he could get out of a tight space because of it. So the only other thing to touch on from the Kilmarnock game was the Kieran Tierney shot.
Oh, phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. I was actually surprised when he lined himself up for a shot, and as soon as he struck it, he was always going to have a chance, but I mean, good grief, that was absolutely tremendous.
It was fantastic. It was one of those ones where when you watch it on the telly, if somebody says to you, you've got to see this goal, I mean, it's good on the telly, but it's not quite the same, because you then know that it's coming. The thing about it when you're at the game is a guy picks the ball up at the edge of the centre circle, takes two steps and then hits it, and it goes in the back in the top corner. It's the surprise of it that's as much as what makes it a great goal, don't you think?
Oh, definitely. As I say there, I was gobsmacked that he was even going to try a shot for there. But I mean, Roger said in an interview last night on the radio after the game that he's got that in him. He's a wonderful striker of a ball, and I think that's something that we might see more in the seasons ahead from Tierney, should he get into position.
Well, hopefully. Anyway, that was those two games. We covered the cup draw. So just one more thing, we've got the Thistle game on Friday night. So what's your prediction for that? You're going?
I'm going to be there, happily enough. I've got tickets. My prediction is my hope is that we keep it going, the form that we're in, and we keep creating chances. And we won't be far away. We won't go far wrong. The last couple of times at Firhill, I think we've won fairly convincingly. So I think Thistle might operate as most teams do these days, and try and frustrate us and keep us out. But the hope is that we've got too much creativity and technique within the team to break them down.
So what's your prediction for the team?
Gordon will be in goals. I think he will go along the lines of Lustig and Tierney as the full backs. Centre backs, I think Siminovic will play. So it's between Beaton and Ayer to get the nod there. Probably Beaton in terms of the giving him game time with the European game coming up. And then you're going to the midfield, you've got Brown and Armstrong. I think McGregor will get a nod in front of Rogic, and on the flanks you will have Sinclair on the left, James Forrest on the right, and Griffiths through the middle. And I'd be confident that that's a team are near enough that they'll pick.
You don't think we'll be resting people
for a
stand on Wednesday night?
You know, we've got a thin squad as it is at the moment, because we do have injuries, you know, but nobody foresaw the fact that Boyata and Shevchenko would get injured, and that's a big chunk of your defensive cover away. So I think Brendan will want them hitting for him and getting into the mould, getting into the groove actually, for so that we can carry on in midweek.
All right, okay, so what's your prediction for the score?
2-0 Celtic.
Okay, with that, I will say St Anthony, thanks very much.
Thanks again, Harry.
Cheers. So as I said at the beginning, thanks very much for everybody who's emailed in, sent comments on Twitter and Facebook, etc. Thanks to Kyle Mulholland, to None of Your Business again, excellent comment on YouTube. Thanks to Serena, who gave me a link to her Instagram page. She says I'm great. Thanks very much, Serena. Interesting Instagram page. And thanks to everybody, Peter Hughes, and too many others to mention who I have lost track of. And I, as I said earlier, I honestly will dig out things like Andrew McLean and others, and your comments, and get your mentions on here. So if you want to write and contact us, you can tweet us or contact podcast at celticunderground.net. This is me, Harry the Brady, saying goodnight and God bless. That was St Anthony. This is Danny Wilson. Good night.